guard a little bit. I'm telling you, I don't have many birthdays, just one a year. It's great to see you in God's house. Let's stand up right now and join someone's hand in agreement that we're going to experience God here today. Amen. Join someone's hand beside you. Let's just agree right now, we've come here to experience God. Let's pray. Father, we join our hearts and our hands together in unity today because we believe that you want to speak to our hearts today. God, we need you, and we need you desperately, and without you, we can do nothing. God, may we never think in some way as a human being that, Lord, we are self-sufficient, that, God, we are independent of you. Oh, God, how dependent we are. The very breath that we breathe, every heartbeat, and if it was not for you, God, there'd be no hope, there'd be no forgiveness, there'd be no heaven. But because of Jesus, your Son and our Savior, we can stand here today and worship the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. May we give you the worship, Lord, that you're worthy of. May we praise you today with all of our hearts is my earnest prayer. Lord, I pray for the Stinson family, that you'd comfort them only as you can, put your arms of love around them. And Lord, I just pray that you'd be with Dreamy and the whole family, God. Take care of them, Lord. And we thank you that you're an ever-present help in time of need. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. All right, I'm going to let you be seated for a moment. We'll shake hands in a minute, but I just wanted us to agree together, and it's great to see you in God's house today. We're always honored to have those of you who are guests, and I always hate doing this because I don't want to put anybody on the spot, but I don't know how to do it any other way, but just to thank you for being here, and we'd like to be able to share with you more about our church here at Gourd Springs. So if you would you lift your hand if you're a guest? Our ushers would like to give you a card to fill out. You're not a guest. Put your hand down. All right. Anyone else? All right. Thank you so much. Just hold your hand up for a moment. JB, there's some over here. All right. Anyone else? By the way, I believe that when we see people come into our church, it's because somebody's encouraged them, invited them. I'm going to encourage all of you. You know, we're not doing our part if we're not inviting and encouraging others to come. So I hope you'll do your part. Y'all looking at me so serious right now. Smile, okay? Maybe people want to come to church, amen? Get excited about the Lord. No? Bless them, Lord, bless them. All right, let me read a couple notes here and we'll move on. Something that's burning on my heart, I've got to say, though. This is just something that's just hot off the press today. And I believe God spoke this in my heart. And I want you to listen to this. Are you ready to hear something? The Bible says, well, let me just read it. I'll take time. I'm telling you, today, if you'll do what God says, someone could get saved in this service today. Somebody could get healed. Someone who's hurting today could go out of here today healed and lifted. If we'll just do our part. And I'm going to really challenge you to do something right now. The Bible says, make a joyful noise in Psalm 100 unto the Lord, all ye lands. Serve the Lord with how? Gladness. We're to be excited about serving God with gladness. Come before his presence with what? Singing. Know ye the Lord that he is God, and that he hath made us, and not we ourselves. We're not self-sufficient. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Now here's what you're supposed to do. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving. Let me tell you something. When you have a heart of gratitude, it changes your whole attitude. Amen. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving, to his courts with what? Praise. Be thankful unto him and bless his name, for the Lord is good. His mercy is everlasting. His truth endureth to all generations. So, preacher, why are you making such a big deal out of this? Something God really spoke to my heart. We're supposed to do it at Gourd Springs. Now, I want you to understand that we all are accountable to God. When the ushers come up and they take up the offering, there might be those who don't have a dime to give. Maybe you don't work. Maybe you're a young person. You don't have a job. Or maybe you're an adult and you don't have a job. And you can't put a dime in the offering plate. But every one of you are to give. You're to give this time in worship. Amen. You can give something. You can give a word of praise to God. So here's the challenge I have for you. No one has said a word. No one's complained. This is me and God talking. God spoke to my heart about this. I don't think, and I never look around. I never look around to see what you were doing during the offering. I'm down here. And the reason I sat on this front pew is so I can worship God. I don't want to get focused on people. I want to get focused on God. So here's what I want to say to you. Don't turn around and talk to your neighbor. Don't say nothing to nobody else. We're here to worship God. And you might not have a dime to put in that offering plate, but folks, you can give worship to God. This is a sacred hour. And I'm just saying this because there might be someone here who really needs to hear from God today. Are y'all listening? Someone, right, really needs to hear from God today. And your little interruption might just mess them up. If you've got to step out during the service, don't speak to someone while they're worshiping God. Just step out gracefully and go to the bathroom. You're not going to bother me, but don't bother anybody else's worshiping. Okay? Now, I just felt led to say that because I just believe that we all have something to give here and we can give God our undivided attention in worship. Let me read this thank you note and we'll move. It says, Dear Gourd Springs Church, thank you for the many thoughts, prayers, and the beautiful plant that was sent our way during the passing of my mom. There is not enough words to express how much it means having such a caring church family. Once again, thank you so much, Lois and Larry Nesbitt and family. And we appreciate them. Keep Larry in your prayers. I don't think he's back. He's been all week in Washington and somewhere else in Washington, North Carolina, with all these storms. He's a volunteer for Red Cross, so be praying for them, okay? And also be praying for the Stenson family. They certainly need our prayers. And Dancy and Emily's here today. We want you to know we love you, and we're behind you. And I tell you, God's given me a word for you today, and I'm so glad you're here. You're going to be glad you came today. I promise that. And be praying for this service tomorrow. The funeral will be Monday at 2 o'clock for little Remy. And did I say it right? Remy. And then the visitation is tonight at Edcott Funeral Home from 6 to 8. Appreciate if you were to come and support this family. It's been a hard, hard thing for them to deal with. And I know there's a lot of questions on a lot of people's minds today, and I believe that's why God's led me to share what he's led me to share. One other thing, please sign up for our new directory. I'm excited about this. It helped me get the names and faces together and also to see maybe how you, because I hadn't figured out, I'll probably never figure out how some of you are related. But anyway, it really will help if all of you participate in this. If you don't participate, you don't get a directory, you don't get a picture, you walk away with nothing. If you participate, they're going to give you a directory, they're going to give you an 8x10 picture. And I've heard some people say, well, I just don't like my picture taken. Well, don't take it for you, take it for me, okay, so I can have it, all right? And it won't cost you a dime. I promise you, no one's going to put any pressure on you. If you can go online, though, and you want to buy pictures, if you'll go online and register it, I think it's like a 10% discount or something, a coupon. Is that what it is? $10. Hey, that's $10. So it pay you to do it online. They're out here at the table, if not. I tell you, it's already getting a little warm in here. I'm a little, can y'all cool it down in here a little bit? All right. I'd appreciate it. All right, let's continue to worship. God bless you.
Yesterday, he died for me. you'd like to stand now, we're going to welcome our neighbors. Go ahead and greet everyone around you. Bless you, please. Family of God.
Why everybody's still standing? If you've got a birthday in the month of May, come on up here. Birthday or anniversary. Come on, birthday in the month of May. Come on. Come on, birthday people. Birthday.
Are you going to do the ministry box back there?
Yeah, I need to do that. Okay, come on, birthdays, anniversaries. Birthdays, anniversaries. Ed, your birthday in May? Good gracious. I tell you what, I know I'm an opinionated person, but the best people are born in May.
Amen.
Amen. Some of y'all didn't get that. All right. We got any anniversaries? Who's the anniversaries?
Carl,
where? Oh, okay. And Mary, all right.
Shirley.
And Shirley. Well, let's honor the anniversaries first. Can we do that? Sing happy anniversary like you do birthday. Happy anniversary to you. Happy anniversary to you. Happy anniversary. God bless you. Happy anniversary to you. Happy birthday to me. All right, I got to take care of two things real quick. JJ is coming up to make a quick announcement. Wednesday night, let me announce this now, because you haven't heard it if you're not here on Wednesday night. I don't know why you wouldn't be here on Wednesday night. But anyway, we're doing a new ministry called Inasmuch. Jesus said, inasmuch as you've done at least these, my brethren. Y'all listening? All right, want to make sure everybody gets this. Inasmuch as you've done at least these, my brethren, you've done it to me. We're doing this ministry for widows and seniors, widows and seniors, that if you've got any need in your home, maybe you've got a ceiling fan and you're an elderly person and you can't get up on a ladder and clean the ceiling fan, well, this man will make sure that the youth will get there and we'll clean your ceiling fan, okay? Because we don't want you fall breaking your neck trying to climb up somewhere on a ladder. We've got some young people that can help you. We've got a lot of good men in this church that can make some repairs to a house. If you need something repaired, some minor repair, and I know the very people that maybe need something are not the kind that will ask. So I've had Randy, one of our deacons, has made a box. It's back here in the Welcome Center. No, it's on this table. As you go out to your left on the table, you'll see a wooden box with a little slit in it. Have we got those sheets? They're beside it. The little sheets are out there beside it. You just put down what your need is. Write it down. And if we can get it done, we'll do it. If we can't do it, we'll try to help you find someone that can, okay? Isn't that a great ministry? Inasmuch for widows and seniors. All right, brother.
I just got one quick announcement. This is June the 21st, kind of reserve your calendars. The youth are going to 50s theme night here at the church. Come dressed in your 50s outfits. We're going to do like a soda jerk behind it, and we're going to serve bought banana splits, root beer floats, hot dogs and chips, and a movie outside, like a drive-in theater-looking deal thing. So come and enjoy it and have a blast. Thank you, sir. That's all I need.
As we get ready to prepare our hearts for our offertory, if you'll stand with me and join me and sing page 333, Leaning on the Everlasting Arms.
Father God, as we come to you for this offering, Father, I just ask that you bless the gift and the giver alike, Father. Be with all those who need us. You need to be in your comfort right now, Father. Just comfort and guard them, Father, and just be with them, Father. Father, I ask that you hide Brother Ronnie as he brings us the word behind the cross, Father. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
You're thankful for that lighthouse? Amen. I'm glad I know the light. Amen. Jesus said, I am the light of the world. No man cometh to the Father but by me. Take your Bibles and turn to the book of Habakkuk. The book of Habakkuk. If you've got the right Bible, it's on page 1012. That's a King James version. The book of Habakkuk. I don't know how to tell you to get there. Just go over to, Daniel, Hosea, Joel, whatever, Amos, take a right somewhere. All right? You got your place? Habakkuk chapter 1. And my message this morning is shake well before using. Shake well before using. God oftentimes will shake our world up. He'll shake us up, but it's not to hurt us, it's to use us. And God wants to use us for His glory. Amen? Habakkuk is a prophet, and his theme is to live by faith. It's so easy to live by sight. I'm giving you a minute to find it, all right? Habakkuk. I can still hear pages, and I'm thankful for you folks while you're turning to your Bibles. One thing I was thankful for when I came here was that you keep up with how many people bring their Bible to church. I think that's a good idea. I think everybody ought to bring their Bible to church. Amen? And if you don't have one, we'll give you one. All right? We'll give you a Bible. But make sure you bring your Bible. And I thought of something while some of you are still looking. During the offertory, that would be a great time to pray for your pastor. Amen? Pray for me. I've got one of Hank Parker's headaches today. But if you see vessels popping out on my head, just say, Lord, help him. I brought me some medicine today. Is this for a headache? No, it's not. I know that. Jack got me that this morning. He said, preacher, when you get done with it, I want it back. So I got to give it back to him. All right, let's all stand in reverence to the reading of God's holy, infallible word. Thank God it's without error. I believe it to be the perfect word of God. Habakkuk chapter 1, verse 1. The burden which Habakkuk the prophet did see. O Lord, how long shall I cry and thou will not hear? Even cry out unto thee of violence and thou will not save. Why doest thou show me iniquity and cause me to behold grievance? For spoiling and violence are before me, and they are that raise up strife and contention. Well, let's pray. We'll follow through with some other scripture. Father, your word is absolute truth. May we stand on the word of God today as the living word that brings life, that brings truth, for you are truth. Thank you that you are the way, you are the truth, you are the life, and you have already given us the light. You are the lighthouse. Help us, oh God, to be your lighthouses wherever we go, that we might point other people to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. Now, Lord, I need you. Without you, I can't do this. Lord, I know that. But I thank you for a church who loves you and wants to learn more about you. And I pray today, Lord, that your word will be expounded upon in such a way that, Lord, we'll not leave the same way we came. Change us, Lord, that we'll leave here more like Jesus. In Jesus' name, I pray for your anointing. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Well, I brought this. I told my new Christians class this morning, I would call it pink stuff. Thank you, Kevin, because she gave me some medicine for my headache, and I've not had anything to drink behind it. Probably why it's not working. Pepto-Bismol. Who in the world came up with that name? Pepto-Bismol. I hate this stuff. It's going to stay sealed. I don't like it. I'll be glad to give it back to you, Jack. It tastes like chalk. I hate it. He said, well, preacher, why would you bring a bottle of Pepto-Bismol to the pulpit? Because I did take the time to highlight it right here. It's in small print, so I had to highlight it so I could see it. Shake well before using. Now, why would, and that's the first thing on here. It says it right there. It says at the very top, drug facts, shake well before using. Why would they tell you to do that? Because all the ingredients are at the bottom, right? All the strength of that medicine has settled down here at the bottom. So they want you to shake it up real good. Why? So you can get the most out of this medicine. The ingredients, the strength of this medicine will be at the top and all around, and then you can pour it in a cup and you can drink this dirty, filthy chalk. So it's supposed to help your tummy. You know, feel better. I told Sherry, I said, I feel a title of a sermon coming. We were going down the road the other day. I said, what about Jonah? I said, how did I come up with that? Yummy, 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 I got Jonah in my tummy. I tell you, maybe that's a children's sermon. But anyway, here's the thing about this stuff. God can even use Pepto-Bismol, this pink stuff. Because a lot of times we allow things in our life to sort of get settled down. I mean, you know, I'm the world's worst. I don't like change. I like comfort zone. And I was over in Wadesboro, minding my own business, in a very comfortable situation, knew everybody by name, knew how they were all related, knew everyone in the county, was loved and appreciated, and thought, well, I'll just stay here till the day I die. And God came over there and shook me up. He did. Shook me up. I tell you, he shook me up more than y'all realize he shook me up. And I'm telling you something, God wanted to shake my world up so he can use me. That's what God did to me. He just turned me upside down. And God can do that to you, can't he? He can just turn it upside down. Someone said, well, we need to get our world turned right side up. It's already upside down. That's the truth. We're already upside down. But God wants to use us is my point. Shake well before using. There comes a time in our lives that our priorities sink down to the bottom of the bottle. Sometimes God has to come along and take us and shake us up well before using us. And this message is to everyone here today, because I'm telling you, there's probably someone here, maybe your priorities are right now, but that don't mean they'll be right tomorrow. And God has a way of helping us see what's important in life. It's funny, when you go through storms, I think about all those people who've lost their homes. You know, what's the first thing that people say when a house burns down or a property's lost by a storm? They say, well, at least our lives were saved. Amen. That was more important than any of the material things, right? I mean, thank God that we got out alive, amen? All of a sudden, all this hard work you've been working for to make a living don't really matter, because all that can be gone in a flash. What matters is that you have your life. So I want us to look at three things, because I know there are a lot of storms that we all face. There are three ways we can deal with these storms of life that come our way. And, you know, you can be, and I'm going to say this today, you can be smack dab right in the center of God's will and a great storm come into your life. I want to show you that today. Three things real quick. Chapter 1 talks about looking at the storm. And I would encourage you, this book's only three chapters long. Looking at the storm brings confusion. Looking at the storm brings confusion. And then I'm going to talk about looking through the storm brings confidence. And then looking beyond the storm brings comfort and clarity. Number one, looking at the storm brings confusion. We're prone to look at the storm and nothing else. All we see is what's wrong. And oftentimes what happens is that when God is wanting to speak to us, we can't hear him because we got our eyes on our problems and not on God. That's one of the main things I want you to understand today, is that Habakkuk in chapter 1, all he's doing is asking questions. Questions after questions. You better be careful of questioning when it comes to God and his work. Questioning God is a dangerous thing. I'm going to go ahead and tell you something you may not like. He's always right. And most of the time, and I'll just speak for myself, I'm usually wrong. You know, I've recognized over the years, you really can't question God. But here's what Habakkuk did. Looking at the storm leads you to a lot of questions. Here is his questions. How long? We question God's timing. Why? We question God's way. What? We question God's purpose. Then we begin to make wrong accusations. As Martha said to Jesus in John 11, 21, concerning her brother Lazarus. Here's what she said. Lord, if thou hast been here, my brother had not died. And Jesus responded in John 11, 25 and 26. I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. Believest thou this? You see, Jesus still loves us, even in the midst of our doubts and our questions. He understands that we're human. He understands that we're, are y'all listening? We're not listening. Many times, we're just not getting it. God sees things in a whole different light than we do. And we need to understand that. Jesus loves us, though, because you see, even in the midst of Martha's questions and her accusations and Mary, what did Jesus do in that same chapter? The Bible says Jesus wept. He understood. It's nothing wrong with crying. I always say to a family that's lost a loved one, grief is good. God wants us to cry. When it hurts, you're supposed to cry. Jesus wept. He was hurting, not because of Lazarus. He was hurting because of the family, for Mary, Martha, and the rest of them. And then I want you to get this word. And I'm just dealing with this, first of all, because when you look at the storm, it can bring all kinds of confusion. You know, Satan's the author of confusion. And when you start asking questions, you're going to get yourself more into the storm. You're going to get deeper in this storm because you're trying to understand it all. And there's a lot of things we won't understand, but this second word's important too, quenching. Don't miss what God is up to. You don't want to quench the power of God that's going on in the storm. There are two kinds of storms in life, in case you haven't learned that yet. There are storms of correction. The biblical illustration would be Jonah. He was in a storm and was thrown overboard from the ship he was in because he was out of the will of God. When he ended up in the belly of the big fish, I thought about this. I bet old Jonah could have used some of this, but I bet the big fish did. Probably he wanted some too because he threw Jonah up on shore. Jonah was out of the will of God. God told him, God gave him a clear word to go to Nineveh. He decides to go to Tarshish. God allows a storm. They throw Jonah off ship. A great fish swallows him up. That's a storm of correction. And then there are storms of perfection. This is most interesting. You'll find this throughout Scripture. It's interesting how Jesus would do things. He would teach the Word of God. He would teach the people a great truth. Then he would allow, are y'all listening? He would allow a life lesson to come into their life. A quiz, if you will. Listen to this. Here's these disciples. They've had a great day that day on the Galilean mountaintop. They had a Galilean mountaintop experience with Jesus. Jesus said, I'm going to go away and pray now, and I want you to get in this ship, and I want you to go on the other side. I'll meet you on the other side. Jesus knew all the time there was going to a storm was going to come up. And Jesus said to his disciples, get in the boat, and I'll be over there on the other side. Now look, they did what God told them to do. They were at the place that God told them to be. They were doing what God told them to do. And right in the midst of that storm in that sea, a great storm began to really come against these disciples. And the Bible says they fought for 3 hours and they got nowhere. Have you ever felt like that in your life? You were getting nowhere quick. Now, hey, you may not be going through a storm right now. It's not a matter of if, it's just a matter of when. So you might want to be taking some notes on this because, folks, you need to know how to deal with the storm. Here's what... Now, this is good. Here's what happened. They're in this storm. They're fighting the storm. They're questioning. They're quenching the power of God. Well, here comes the power of God, and he's walking on the water. Here's the way I see it. Hey, what's over your head is under his feet. You see, it's just a matter of how you're looking at it. They were afraid for their life. I mean, their ship was going down for the last time. They were ready to throw in the towel. Jesus walks in on the water. And that just tells me that whatever storm you're going through, whatever is over your head is under his feet. Friend, I don't understand all the ways of God, but I know he's God. It don't matter what happens. It don't matter what storm you're going through. I'm telling you, he's God. And then the third word is a dangerous word in the church. I see it all the time. Every church I've pastored, I watch quitters, quitting. What we see is our disappointments. God sees as appointments. I've seen people go through trials and quit on God. Well, why did God allow this? Why did God do this? Where was God when I needed him most? And they quit. I've seen it. I don't understand it. I'm totally confused as a pastor. Why in the world do people run from God when they need him most? I am so glad to see Dancy and Emily here and her family this morning. I personally think you're in the best place you could be today. I'd rather draw near to God than draw away from God. I'll tell you something, friend. It's a serious thing to quit. We've got ex-church members today. We've got ex-Sunday school teachers. We've got ex-choir members, ex. We need to let God ex us out and let his cross get into us and make us right with him. Folks, I'm going to tell you something. God wants us to see him in the storm. So let's move on to the next thing. You see, that's what those disciples saw. They saw Jesus in the storm. Now, looking at the storm brings confusion, but looking through the storm brings confidence. Look at chapter 2. Turn to chapter 2 there. It's right there on the same page in my Bible. Chapter 2, verse 1. I will stand upon my watch and will set me upon the tower and will watch to see what he will say to me. Now look, folks, I think that verse right there, that what I just read is the most important thing I've got to say today. What he will say to me and what I shall answer when I am reproved. And the Lord answered me and said, write the vision and make it plain upon the tables that he may run that readeth it. For the vision is yet for an appointed time, But at the end it shall speak, not lie, though it tarry. Wait for it, because it will surely come. It will not tarry. Behold, his soul, which is lifted up, is not upright in him, but the just shall live by faith. Let's unpack that. You might say, well, Pastor, it sounds pretty good that you're dealing with preaching about a storm today, but how do you work through that storm? You've got to get, number one, the right perspective. You see, it's how you look at things. It's how you see things. I was reading this little story about Yogi Berra. He was a great catcher for the New York Yankees, and he was known for his speech, his way of taunting the opposing team. He would always carry on some junk with a batter. Well, the batter in front of him this day was none other but Hank Aaron. And old Yogi was teasing him and taunting him and said, "Hey, Yogi, have you read the words on the bat? You better look at the word," just trying to get him off his game so he wouldn't hit the ball. Said, "You better read those words to see if that bat was made in the USA." Well, the ball came across the plate, and old Hank missed the first throw, strike. Old Yogi kept aggravating Hank. Said, "Hey, you better read what's on that bat." He said, "And by the way, when you read it, make sure the words are lined up with the ball now. You've got to make sure." Now, he's just talking junk to him. Said, "You better have those words straight up so you can read that bat well and line it up with the ball." Ball number two came across, strike. He kept on aggravating this man, and the ball came across the third time, and Hank Aaron knocked it out of the ball field. I mean, he knocked a home run. He got around all the bases. He came around home. He got right in Yogi's face, and he said, "Yogi, I didn't come here to read. I came to hit the ball." I'm going to tell you something, folks. We got to keep the main thing the main thing. We've got to be focused on what's most important. In church, I'm amazed as a pastor how people get just sidetracked over the least little thing. Well, this is not right. That's not right. This is not perfect. Who said everything had to be by your standard? I mean, why is it that we've got to have our way? It's got to be my kind of music. Well, if it's not God's kind of music, we're all sunk. Amen. Well, it's got to be my style of preaching. Well, if it's not of God, you might as well just stay at home. Amen? I'm going to tell you something, folks. I'd rather miss my ways than miss God's way. Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh to the Father but by me." Here's another thing. God instructed Habakkuk to go to the watchtower that he might begin to look from God's perspective at the issue of evil and suffering. You see, in modern day Israel, it is not uncommon to pass through the countryside and see a watchtower. It's a stone structure where one could see the layout of the whole land. And this is what God was saying to Habakkuk. "All right, I want to show you. You're in a storm. I want you to show you who I am, but you've got to get up in the right place." And I'm going to ask you, are you in the right place in your life? I'm telling you, the best place for you to be is in the watchtower. No wonder Jesus said, "You're to watch and pray." I'm going to tell you something, folks. It's powerful when you pray. Now, I'm fixing to teach you a great truth here. If you will learn this, you'll learn to make it through the storm. Are y'all listening? Please, no one interrupting the service. Be still. I want you to recognize this. God wants us to gaze on him and glance on the storm. I can see the pulpit out of the side of my eyes, but I'm not looking at the pulpit. I'm looking at those doors back there. Folks, I'm going to tell you, if you're going to go somewhere, you need to keep your eyes on where you're going. Amen? You need to know where you're going. I'm going to heaven. How about you? I want to keep my eyes on Jesus. I want to keep my eyes on heaven. We need to have a heavenly perspective so we can be some earthly good. Amen? Amen? I want you to think with me. If you put your gaze on Jesus, what would happen? The things of this world will grow strangely dim in the light of my glory and grace. And I've asked Jeff to put a picture up here. It's a little experiment I want to do today. Now, you're talking about a storm. That looks like a messy storm. You see the four dots up there? You've probably seen this. But I want you to look at the four dots and just look at it for about 30 seconds, all right? Don't look at nothing else. I want you to put your gaze on the four dots. There's one, two, three, four, right? All right, let's look at them. Everybody got their eyes on the four dots? We're going to experiment now, okay? Everybody got your eyes on the four dots. Don't look to me. Don't look to the right. Don't look to the left. Look to the four dots. All right, here we go. 30 seconds. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30. Now close your eyes. Just close your eyes. What do you see? Woo, glory. I tell you what, if we get our eyes off the storm and quit looking at all the junk, I mean, that looks like a bunch of junk. But you just get your eyes off. You say, preacher, don't you do that to me no more. I'm just trying to get your eyes on Jesus, and sometimes you need to shut your eyes to the things around you.
Amen.
I tell you what I saw when I closed my eyes. I saw a perfect picture of Jesus.
Amen.
Woo, glory. That's enough for a Baptist preacher to shout. I'm going to have me a spell right here this morning. Folks, I'm telling you something. If the church of Jesus Christ would get their eyes on Jesus, get your eyes on the prize. You say, preacher, that's just some kind of illusion or something. I don't know. It looks like a storm to me. But I'm going to tell you what I think. I think he knows how to get you through the storm. Amen. I tell you, he's been through some storms. And the storms of life are hard. By the way, Jesus was touched in every area as we are. He knows. And by the way, he went through the greatest storm of all, the storm of your sin. So we got to have the right perspective. And then, look at the next word. We've got to be patient. Look at verse 3 again. He says that we are to wait for it because it will surely come. The psalmist said, those who wait upon the Lord are like those who watch for the morning. Friend, the sun don't come up on my watch. It comes up on God's watch. God said, be still and know that I'm God. He's always on time. He's never late. We get impatient. I'll raise my hand. I'll raise both of them. I get impatient. But the Bible says, wait upon the Lord. Waiting time is not wasted time. Waiting time is trusting time. You're saying, God, I'm waiting for you to come through. You say, well, Preacher Ronnie, what if he don't come through? Look up here, folks. He always comes through.
Amen.
He always comes through. I said he always comes through.
Amen.
We don't understand. Why is it? I don't know. Why is it that people have to suffer in this life? Why is it that a little baby like Remy don't even get a chance to have a life? Why is it that God would take such an innocent, precious little child? I don't understand all the answers to the questions because I'm not focused on the questions, but I'm going to give this focus to Dancy and Emily right now. God knows what he's doing. And you know, he had spinal meningitis, which could have very well, he could have had a hard, difficult life mentally. And we don't understand. Do I have all the answers? No. I just know this. Keep your eyes on the one who will see you through the storm. I'm telling you something. Life is hard. And I don't claim to have all the answers. I'll tell you what, though, I know the one who does. And I've already met with Emily and with Dancy, and here's what I assured them. They will see little Remy again.
Amen.
Now, some people say, no, a baby can't go to heaven. Oh, yes, it does. You know why? Because the baby never sinned.
Amen.
Baby never did anything wrong. You say, well, I thought everyone needed a Savior. Jesus said, allow the children to come to me. He said, you need a childlike faith to be saved. And the way I look at it, I tell you, God is a God that he's not going to allow a little baby to spend eternity in hell. Baby's never done anything wrong. But by the grace of God, friend, you're going to get to heaven. Amen.
Amen.
David said this when he lost his little baby. He said, the baby cannot come back to me. But David said this, I can go to him.
Amen.
Thank God that we can. Amen. Thank God there is a heaven. And you know what? I know it's tough down here. I know a lot of us. I think about people who are going through suffering and sickness and all that. I tell you, I don't understand it, but this is what I do know. You get this perspective. Patience Patience is waiting on God, knowing that God will come through. He says, because it will surely come, he will not tarry. And if God said it, that settles it. I believe that's enough. And then look at the promise. He says, it will come. You need to find God's promise here. And when you're being shaken up and your life has been turned upside down, here's what you do. Stand there. You find a promise you can stand on. I mean, when everything's torn upside down, here's one of my favorite verses to stand on. You see, the Bible says, how does faith come? Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Here's one of my favorite verses, Isaiah 41:10. Fear thy not, for I am with thee. Be not dismayed, for I am thy God. I will strengthen thee. Yea, I will help thee. And I love this part. Yea, I will uphold thee with the right hand of my righteousness. I see God able to hold up the whole world in one hand. Whew. I don't know about you, but I'd rather be in his hands than in your hands, or in my hands, or than in a doctor's hands, or a nurse's hands, or some kind of medication. I'd rather be in the hands of God. And friend, I'd rather know, and just like little Remy, I know that he's in the hands of God. God knows what he's doing. I don't understand it. I know that if I was the mama and I was the daddy, I'd want that child here today. But I know this, that we all are in God's hands. And you know what? It's not going to be much longer that we're out of here. Be patient. He's coming again. Amen. He's coming. And you can count on it. Hey, how do I know that? He came the first time. Amen. He can do it again. And he's coming again. I believe it's real soon. Sooner than you think. Some of us are worried about getting out at 12 o'clock. I'm more concerned about getting you into eternity than getting you out at 12 o'clock. I really am. I mean, we start 11 o'clock sharp, end 12 o'clock dull, and we don't know whether we're going to heaven or not. Bless God, I'm going to stand on the promises while you sit on the premises. Amen. Amen. I'm going to get up here and proclaim the word of God. God says, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. The Bible says that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus Christ, thou shalt be saved. I'm going to preach the thou shalts because God says I shall do it. Don't worry about God not coming through. You better make sure you come through. Amen. You better make sure you pray through. You get in that watchtower. See what God will do. Be patient. Stand on the promise. And then, listen, I'm not done. Participate. There must be participation. Prayer is never passive. It's active. And it says in verse 4, the just shall live by what? His faith. God wants you to know that he is with you. So you must participate with God. I am weak. That's the truth. But he is strong. My faith is weak. But his faithfulness is strong. My righteousness is as filthy rags, but his righteousness is holy, pure, and perfect. Hey, I'm just going to count on him. You say, preacher, that don't sound like you're participating. Yeah, it is. You know how I got saved? I said, I'm a sinner. And he said, I'll save you then. Now, if I thought I'd already arrived and didn't need a Savior, I couldn't have got saved. But because I said I'm a sinner, I participated with God and agreed with God, and I got saved. Are y'all listening? I don't feel so hot this morning. My head's hurting. But I'm weak. He's strong. I love what Hank said. I'm not going to focus on what's wrong. I'm going to focus on what's right. Amen. You want to get healed? Focus on what's right. Anybody can focus on what's wrong. The whole world's pointing that to our lives every day. Turn on the news. You'll find out everything wrong. But I'm going to tell you something, folks. Participate in putting your faith in God. I'd rather have his righteousness. My righteousness is filthy rags. And then the perception, verse 20. Look at verse 20 of chapter 2. But the Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the earth keep silent before him. The Lord is in his holy temple. What is he saying? Folks, God has not abdicated his throne. He's still God regardless of what happens down here on this earth. Get this perception. Although God may not save you from your storm, he will save you through the storm. Verse 2 of the song, my hope is built on nothing less. Listen to this. When darkness veils his lovely face, I love this song, I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. On Christ, the solid rock, I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. I tell you, folks, what are you standing on? I'll tell you what we reveal. We reveal what we're standing on when we go through these storms. Storms have a way of revealing how weak we are. You take an old pine tree, some ice storm or something can just tilt it right over. You take a big old oak tree that's been there a long, long time and it's got a lot of roots and it's throughout the ground, it ain't going nowhere. I'm just here to tell you this, folks. God is a solid rock and you can stand on him. I said, God is a solid rock and you can stand on him.
Amen.
But I'm not done yet. It's going to get a lot hotter in here yet. Looking beyond the storm brings clarity or comfort. Looking beyond the storm brings comfort and clarity. Look what he says in chapter 3 of verse 2. O Lord, I have heard thy speech. Now here's a whole different way of looking at things. Chapter 1, he's asking all these questions. Chapter 2, he's got up in the watchtower. He's gained a new perspective. Chapter 3, he's saying, I've heard from the Lord. I wonder if anybody's heard from the Lord. Look, O Lord, I've heard thy speech and was afraid. O Lord, revive thy work in the midst of the years. In the midst of the years, make known. In wrath, remember mercy. I'm going to tell you, we just had one of the greatest revivals I think a church can have.
Amen.
You know how I know that? I know some things you don't know. I do. I have privileged information. I do. I'm going to tell you about it. Without breaking confidentiality with anybody, God brought great conviction in the hearts of many people in this church.
Amen.
And I will make this promise to you today. You will, in the next few weeks, see some great changes in this church. Because people are getting right with God.
Amen.
They are. You see, I know I'm a different kind of preacher. When I went to North Wadesboro, one of the deacon's wives told me, we ain't never had a preacher like you. Well, I'm sure you've already come to that conclusion here. But I am not. God's not called me to be God. God's not called me to be the Holy Spirit. And I'm sure not Gomer or Barney or whoever it was that said, citizens arrest, citizens arrest. Always pointing a finger that someone's doing something wrong. Here's what I believe. And I know this is different than the way most preachers and deacons deal with church discipline. I believe if you preach this truth right here, people will get under conviction and they'll get right. You see, the Bible says the word of God is a two-edged sword. Now, if I cut you with my words, I can't heal you. But if God cuts you with his word, he can heal you. You see, that's why I'm trying to be very careful what I say from this pulpit. I never, ever want to fall into this trap as a pastor. Well, somebody said something to the preacher. Now he's preaching in the pulpit. No, God didn't call me to preach what I think. He called me to preach what he thinks. And his word will do a whole lot more here than my word ever could. Amen? And so the way I look at it, if I speak a sharp word to you, it'll cut you and you won't be healed. And there'll be hurt feelings. But if God speaks, he'll cut you twice as much. It's a double-edged sword. But he'll heal you. And by the way, I'm going to say it again. You're going to see God do some great works in this church. You say, preacher, how do you know that? Well, I've already been told. I have. I believe it all in my heart. Then not only did we see people get saved or join the church, but we saw some church members getting right. And I believe with all my heart that when real revival comes, there comes great conviction to the heart. And only God can convict our heart and show us our needs. Thank God for that. You're talking about a revival. The storm of sin is man's greatest storm, and God showed up on the cross in Jesus Christ to save us from our sin. I'm going to tell you something. I can have a revival just looking at the cross. Oh, there's one there. There he is. I'm here to tell you something. Jesus is alive today. He arose from the grave, and this is the gospel. I can have a revival just based on what we did the other week on Easter. Amen. I just believe that the church ought to be in a revival all the time. I don't believe you ought to ever have to have a revival. I don't. I don't believe you ever ought to have a revival meeting. You ought to be in revival all the time. Amen. I mean, wouldn't it be something if you came to church every Sunday and felt like you was in a revival?
Praise God for that. God wants to show up, and he wants to show us just who he is in the midst of the storm. I'm telling you something. We've got people dying of cancer. We've got people going through all kinds of surgeries. We've got problems. We've got people hurting. We've got death. But I'm telling you something. God is still God, and people need to come to church and hear that there's hope in Jesus Christ. Your heart can be restored. It can be revived today. And then the next word. You may not feel like it today when you're in a storm, but when you get your perspective right and you're looking beyond the storm to bring comfort and clarity, you rejoice. Look at verse 18. Now, I want you to note the I wills here. Yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will joy in the God of my salvation. Why did he say that? Because of the two he wills in verse 19. The Lord God is my strength. He will make my feet like hinds' feet. What is that? A deer. And he will make me to walk upon my high places. He will. You see, the two I wills in verse 18 are because of the two he wills in verse 19. In other words, what is it? You ever seen a deer? You've seen a deer. And you know how a deer jumps? I got a little granddaughter. When she was just a little thing, we would ask her, you know, what does the cow say? And she'd say, moo, moo. What does the pig say, oink, oink? And what does the deer say? And she'd say, car. Now here's the thing about a deer. A deer don't just run. A deer leaps. I mean, it don't just walk, it runs. What's the point here? This is what God will do. He will give you a life that you will be able to jump over these hurdles in life. You don't have to live in the valley. Amen. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Because he is the shepherd. He always leads his sheep through greener pastures, not down a briar pathway, but through greener pastures. I can rejoice in the God of my salvation. It don't matter what comes my way. God is still God. And what's over my head is under his feet. He is Lord of all. And I can rejoice. You see, the devil wants to take your joy away from you. You see, the devil loves it when you get depressed. He loves it when you get down. He loves you. He just loves it when you throw up your hands and you want to quit on your wife or your husband. Don't quit. God said, don't quit. I mean, why is it we want to quit? I mean, I've never seen so many young people today with as little commitment as any generation ever. Well, if it don't work out my way, I'm quitting. That's not what God's saying. And if you do marriage God's way, you won't be quitting. You know why people quit on marriage? Because they did it their way. But you do it God's way. The Bible says, what God hath joined together, let no man put asunder. You say, well, preacher, my marriage is already gone. Well, let me tell you something. Here's what you do. As a widow or as a single woman, you make Jesus your husband. Amen. You just keep your eyes on him. And you know what? He'll bring you through that storm, and he'll do things better than you ever thought he could do. Last all, and I'm done, raised. He raised me up. You see, love lifted me. You say, preacher, where do you see that? I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore, verily, very deeply stained within, sinking to rise no more. But the master of the sea heard my despairing cry, and from the waters lifted me. Now safe am I. Love lifted me. Love lifted me. When nothing else would help, love lifted me. Oh, listen, this church, this is why we need to be raised up, because he'll pick us up like the deer picks up his hind feet. He'll pick up and we can leap for the Lord. We can be raised up. By the way, our Lord was raised up. He wants to raise you up in this storm. Love lifted me. And he says, all my heart to him I give, ever to him I cling. In his blessed presence live, ever his praises sing. Love so mighty and so true merits my soul's best song. Faithful, loving service to him belong. Oh, listen to this. If you're lost today, souls in danger, look above. Jesus completely saves. He will lift you by his love out of the angry waves. He's the master of the sea. Billows his will obey. He, your Savior, wants to be. Be saved today. Psalm 42 and 3 says, He brought me up also out of a horrible pit, out of the miry clay, and He set my feet upon a rock and established my goings. And He hath put a new song in my mouth, even praise unto my God. Many shall see it in fear and shall trust in the Lord. You know what that verse tells me? That I was lost and on my way to a devil's hell. He brought me up out of a miry clay. Hey, I serve a God who can stoop over as far as He needs to scoop over. But I like this. Not only can He stoop over, but He can scoop. I serve a God who can stoop and He can scoop. I like that. Because you know what? That's what He'll do for you today. He'll pick you up out of your storm today. Oh, yes. He'll help you through it. You see, he may not keep you from the storm, but He'll be with you through the storm. Amen. I want you to understand that today. But I want to give you one last thought. And I thought, well, if they don't remember anything else, Lord, help them remember this. So I thought I'd save this to last and give an invitation. Go back to point number one. When we're confused because we're asking all these questions, listen to this thought. When I was studying this, I thought about it. While you're so busy asking your questions, you couldn't hear God if He was speaking. God was speaking to Habakkuk all the time. You see, God has not changed. People ask, where is God? Well, I'll tell you where God is. He's right where you left Him. God's not changed. They asked the question, where was God at 9/11? I'll tell you where God was. He was right there. In the midst of all that storm, He was right there. I'll never forget that day. I was supposed to preach that night. I couldn't. Didn't know a person in the World Trade Centers. But I watched those people jump out of those windows. And I'll tell you, that did something to me. I don't deal too good with people jumping out of windows because in my thought, this was my thinking. Lord, are they going to heaven or are they going to hell? They just made a decision to jump out of a window. And I understand why. The buildings were being destroyed by fire. Storms will come. Are y'all listening today? They will come. But when that storm comes, and maybe you're in a World Trade Center, and you've got to make a decision, do you know whether or not you're prepared to meet God? Truth be known, tomorrow's not promised for any of us. Amen. We think about little Remy, but what about you too? Because you know what? There's no promise for any of us. And I'm going to preach his funeral tomorrow, and I'm going to preach heaven because that's where he is. But if I was to preach your funeral, could I stand in this pulpit with such confidence and such authority and say, well, I know this person is in heaven? You say, well, preacher, this is different. It's a little baby. Well, are you a child of God? Have you given your heart and your life to Jesus Christ? I'm telling you, the greatest storm, look up here, and I'm almost done. The greatest storm we all are facing is the storms of sin. And Jesus came to take care of that storm. Will you let Him save your soul today? You say, well, preacher, I'm a member of this church. I joined the church when it was started, I accepted Christ. I joined the church and I was baptized. But let me ask you something. Has your life changed? If it hadn't changed, I hate to tell you this, you were never saved. If any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things have passed away, and behold, all things become new. He will change lives. Has He changed your life? Are you still in sin? If you're going to see God do a work in you today, quit being so angry with God about everything and start looking at yourself. Instead of asking all these questions, why don't you right now take a moment? I know time's running, but take a moment right now where you are and see if you can hear God. Every head bowed, every eyes closed. I want you to just take a moment. Every head bowed, every eyes closed. Has God brought something to your mind today? Is there something right now going on? Just take a hard look right now inside of you. And if you were to die today, where would you go? Do you have the assurance that you would be in heaven? I'm telling you, the greatest storm that man has ever faced, God took care of on the cross. And because he arose from the grave, he has the power to save you today. But you've got to participate. You've got to put your faith in him. And you've got to be willing to say, I'm a sinner, God. And God saves sinners. You're here today and you are saved. The Holy Spirit's at work here today. Are you living for him? Are you doing what is right? Is there some area in your life that if the Lord was to come back this very moment, right now at the end of this service, you would be ashamed of something that you haven't dealt with? I don't know anyone's heart here today, but God knows you. And if we're going to see God do a real work, then we've got to get right. We've got to be for real. Would you come today and let him take over your life? What's over your head, you don't understand how you're going to do it, but what's over your head is under his feet. It's faith in his word, faith in Jesus Christ, that will change your life. Father, I pray today that lives would be changed. Lord, we all know what storms are like. We've all been in some type of storm. We've all dealt with the storm of sin. But thank you that Jesus went to the cross and paid our sin debt. And he went through that storm of Calvary. And he arose on the third day, giving us victory over sin, death, and the grave. And because he lives, we live. I pray in Jesus' name, this invitation, Lord, you would do a work only you could do. May revival continue in this church. Because God, we desire it. We hunger for righteousness. Do a work here today that only you can do. May lives be changed. In Jesus' name. Our deacons are going to be coming at the altar today. If you want someone to pray with you, they'll be down here. Let's all stand and sing. I'll be here in front of the Lord's table. You trust him. Come to him. I'll tell you what's over your head is under his feet. Let's sing.
Thank you.
I don't usually do this, but if you know it is well with your soul, you can honestly sing that today. And you're not being arrogant, you're not being prideful, but you want to lift up a hand and praise God today. Would you lift your hand? Wow, that's a beautiful sight to behold. Isn't it wonderful we can lift our hand and say, it is well with my soul. As your hands are put down, let me say to you, church, I love you. I'm not against you. I'm for you. Don't be ashamed to lift your hands in the sanctuary and thank God for saving you. Don't ever be ashamed of the one who lifted both hands on the cross. He says, enter into my courts with thanksgiving and with praise. I'm so thankful you could raise your hand. But maybe, and I'm not going to come to you, I'm not going to embarrass you. That's not what I want to do right now, but I just want to pray with you. If you'd like to slip up your hand, maybe you're a guest here today, maybe you're a member of this church, and you're just saying, preacher, I'm not sure that it's well. I'm not sure that it's well. Would you just pray for me? And I promise you, I see you. God bless you. I promise you, I'm not going to come to you and embarrass you. I'm just going to honestly pray, and I'm not going to go out and tell who raised their hand. I promise you that. Anyone else? I see it. God bless you. Anyone else? Thank you. And over here, I thank you, and thank you. God bless you. I love you for being honest. You're making steps to God when you raise your hand. I've counted about five hands. Anyone else? Thank you. God bless you. There's several people here today who are being real before God. And I want to say to you, because you're trying to be real, and you didn't have to raise your hand, but you did, you can become right. Right now, right where you are, I want to pray this prayer. Usually Sherry and I go out to the door, and this is more important. Those of you who raised your hand, if you right now would realize, and you've done that by raising your hand, it's not well with your soul and you need to be saved. Are you willing to turn from sin? Are you willing to say, I'm sick and tired of being under the storm? I want to walk over the storm. I want to have victory over this storm of sin. Well, I'm here to tell you, salvation's a gift. And if you'll receive Jesus Christ as your Savior, what's over your head is under His feet. He's already done it. He said it's finished. He paid the price. Your sin debt has already been paid for. What you need to do is simply receive what Jesus has already done for you. As our heads are bowed and our eyes closed, and our closing prayer is going to be a sinner's prayer. And I'm going to ask this whole church to help me. Everyone here, would you pray with these several people? Would you pray with them right now? I'm going to lead the whole church in a sinner's prayer. And we're going to all pray. And if you want to pray this prayer to receive Christ for the very first time, you invite Him into your heart, would you pray that prayer right now? I'm asking the church to lead you to Christ right now. As I lead them, you pray this prayer. The church is praying it, and you pray it if you want to receive Jesus Christ, your Savior. And you go out the door today, say, Pastor, thank you for praying that prayer. I've received Christ. Let's pray now. And the whole church is going to pray out loud, and you can pray silently, okay? God will hear your prayer. He will. He'll hear the prayer of a repentant heart. You've already raised your hand saying, I need to know that it's well with my soul. Let's pray. All right, church, here we go. We're going to pray with them, and you that want to pray to receive Christ, you can pray silently. The church is going to pray out loud. Let's all pray. Say, Dear God, we believe in Jesus. We believe He died on the cross for all of our sins. We believe He rose from the grave that we might have life and have it everlasting. Dear God, I know I've sinned. And I ask you, Lord Jesus, to forgive me of all my sins, to come into my heart and save my soul. And from this day on, I want to know that it's well with my soul. Now help me to get in church and grow in your word. In Jesus' name. Would you turn and tell someone you love them before you leave today? God bless you.